Go, Peeper!
So what are we having for dinner?
Tonight we're going to be making Lithuanian borscht, which is
cold borscht as opposed to what most people are used to. And usually people put sour cream in it, and I'm using Tofutti sour cream, which is the non-dairy alternative, which works even better than the regular sour cream. So we have beets, cucumbers, potatoes, got to use a lot of dill, salt and pepper, white wine vinegar. About it with the sour cream. And then once you're done with it and you let it cool, you're going to fry up some onions and put that right on top of the soup. So you're going to have that nice caramelized onion thing going on top of it. And I have to say, a lot of people get turned off by the color. The color is going to be a little bit lighter than that once I have the sour cream, so it kind of looks like Pepto-Bismol, but it's unbelievably good. I actually discovered, not this recipe, but the soup itself, in a place in Brooklyn called Eva's Restaurant in Sunset Park, and it was this Polish place, actually, where I used to go have pierogies, and they had this soup there one day, and I was like, I didn't want to try it, because it was pink, but I did, I gave in, and then after that it was like, I went back to that place like every week. And they only make it in the summer. It's a summer soup because it's cold, obviously. But the funny thing is that it's made with beets, which is a winter vegetable. So in order to make this soup, you need about 3 pounds of beets. I never know how much 3 pounds of beets are, so I just grab a bunch of them. So this is how much I grab. What you're going to do is you're going to first wash these beets really well and scrub them. And then you're going to put them in a pot with about 6 cups of water, and I also throw in some vegetable broth. Not too much. I just do, sprinkle some in there. And then I put all the beets in there and wait for the water to boil. And once it boils, I then turn the fire down to low and let it simmer for about, you have to keep poking it with a fork to get them just a little bit tender, not too soft. I took them out after they got to the right tenderness, and I let them cool off. So that's the next step. So what you can do is you're gonna peel all the beets, and I use a potato peeler. I don't know if there's another way to do it, but it's really easy to peel beets once you cook them, because the skin just sort of comes right off. And you gotta really make sure you get the skin off, because then you're gonna have sort of skin in your soup.
Who wants that?
Yeah, who wants that? So what you're gonna do next is you're gonna julienne 3/4 of the beets that you've peeled, and the rest of them you're gonna grate. So I have this really handy dandy machine that is really cool, because it has all these different sort of insets. Like, I have some other ones with small, you can make French fries and do all sorts of cool things. Anyway, and it's really easy to clean, unlike, food processors. So what I do is just put that beet in there like that. The funny thing is that I hate beets. If you don't like beets, I think you really like this soup. Okay, got the julienne beets, and now I'm going to do a little grating action. I like to use this side of the grater for this part.
Which part is best for knuckles?
Julienne beets and the grated beets. Okay, I need 2 cups of cucumbers, which are going to go in with the beets. These are cucumbers from our garden, aren't they beautiful? I am going to peel them. I suppose I could probably do the skin on them, since they're from our garden. But
I like the skin.
So used to doing this. All right, I'm getting these cucumbers ready, because we're not grating any cucumbers, but we are julienne. I really recommend one of these things for everybody. 2 cups. I think 2 cucumbers will probably be enough. 2 cups. I never have enough cucumbers, actually. Here comes the fun part, when you add all the stuff to the soup. Okay, so the water that you have cooked the beets in is now cool, of course, and you're gonna have to warm it up again. And what you're gonna do is you're gonna add all the cucumbers, add all the beets. Okay. Pull that up a little bit. Now we're going to add dill, very important ingredient. I think that the dill just brings out all the flavors that you're putting in here, like the white wine vinegar, potatoes. It just, so I use more than one tablespoon. So you're going to add that in there. Stir that up a little bit. Oh yeah. Okay, vinegar. This is the most important thing. You gotta use white wine vinegar. You can't use the regular vinegar. Some of the recipe call for distilled vinegar, but you really gotta use that. Stir that up a little bit. Now, the rest is real simple. You're gonna just put some salt and pepper in. Half a teaspoon of salt. And I put that far away, because I already used it. I can't be measuring this, so I'm just gonna... You know, you could always put more in there later. That should do it. Stir that up a little bit. Okay. So what's gonna happen now? This has gotta boil. So we're gonna wait for that to boil, and then we're gonna simmer it for about 15 minutes. And then we're gonna do the next step, which is taking some of the liquid out of there and mixing it up with the sour cream and putting it aside and then adding it later and doing all sorts of fancy stuff. Okay, we're gonna let that cool a little bit and then take about a cup of it out of the liquid, put it in a bowl, and then add that sour cream and mix it up real good and then put it back in there. And then it's pretty much done, except for sautéing the onions, which will go on to the cold soup. That's about the last step. So all that needs to be done now at this point is, I'm gonna give it another couple minutes to just do its thing in there. And then I'm gonna shut it off, just let it get a little cool. And then we're set to go. Well, we're not really set to go. It's gotta cool down. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put it in the refrigerator and cool it real fast, or maybe even in the freezer. Actually, I'm gonna put it in the fridge. Take that puppy, put it in there for a while. Wow, that's hot. Okay, well, we've let the soup cool for a while. Take a cup of the broth out only. We don't want to get any of the beets or anything else. We're going to do our best not to get any of that out of there. Tricky business. Okay, here we go. Got about a cup of liquid in there. And now we're going to take our sour cream and we're going to mix up all 2 cups of it with that 1 cup of broth. I'm going to use this little whiskey thing, and you see how it's turning this pink color? Believe it or not, just adding that 12 ounces of sour cream to this 1 cup of broth is going to turn that whole soup into this pink color. And what I'm going to do now is just pour that back in there. Stir that up real good. That's going to be good.
So Aram is gone now, and I was under orders not to touch the borscht because it's not quite cold enough, but I can't wait anymore. So I'm going to make myself a bowl of soup and hope that he doesn't hear me. As he said, the best way to serve the soup is to put a bunch of grilled onions on top of it. So I've got my cast iron pan with oil from my tempeh from this morning, and I've got the onions going. I'm not going to take too much so he doesn't notice. Look how beautiful that is. I just love that. I like the bowl. You shouldn't mix them like this until the first little bits are really, really crunchy. It's very tempting to start mixing them up too soon. And I just lay those right on top of the soup. And there you go. Perfect bowl of borscht. The original version of this Lithuanian borscht included chicken broth instead of a mixture of water and vegetable broth. So what I thought I'd like to do tonight is ask you to imagine that we did in fact use chicken broth in this soup. So close your eyes and imagine us in the grocery store picking out a can of chicken broth. Now I want you to step back in time because I'm going to tell you what happened before we picked up that can of chicken broth. Because in that can is a chicken. And if you go back further in time and close your eyes, I want you to imagine a poultry house. It's filled with 20,000 chickens. They're all white, they're all identical, and they're all about 5 to 6 weeks of age because that's when they're killed. I want you to go into that house and I want you to look at the bodies on that floor. A lot of them are dead and their siblings, for all intents and purposes, are trampling all over them. Some of them are dead inches from the water bowl because they couldn't reach it. Their legs were deformed. Their skin is scalded off their chests. They can't move. In case you don't know, the reasons the chickens are scalded in the poultry houses is because of the intensity of ammonia that's in their feces, which is covering the floor inches deep. The whole place reeks of ammonia. I've been in chicken houses both full of chickens and after the trucks have come to take pretty much everyone away except for the ones I wanted to rescue, I could barely breathe in there. And that was after the doors had been open for days. So that is why the chicken skin is scalded half the time, why their eyes burn all the time, and why they can barely breathe half the time. And those are the ones who are not in your chicken broth. The ones who end up in your chicken broth are your friends, who are thrown literally by their feet into a truck, taken to a slaughterhouse, strung up by their feet, electrocuted, and then killed by a series of whirring blades that cuts their necks off. Sometimes it doesn't work the first time, so they dangle there, dying with their head half off. Those are the chickens who go into that chicken broth. That's what is behind that one ingredient in this recipe. So what I want you to do is keep your eyes closed and remind yourself that we don't deserve to put anything we want in our mouths. We need to stop this death. And it starts one meal at a time, just like tonight. Go vegan. If you'd like to learn more about Vine Sanctuary, find us on the internet at vine.bravebirds.org.